once again, and I love the way that ends. If you're all stressed.
Hi, everybody. Today, this first Sunday in Advent, we celebrate God's promise of hope. Please hear these words predicting this promise, written by the prophet Isaiah 760 years before the birth of Jesus. If you all would turn to Isaiah chapter 2, verse 2 through 4. I'll give you a second to do that. Okay. So, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house will be the highest of all, the most important place on earth. It will be raised above the other hills, and people from all over the world will stream there to worship. People from many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of Jacob's God. There he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths." For the Lord's teaching will go out from Zion. His words will go out from Jerusalem. The Lord will mediate between nations and will settle international disputes. They will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will no longer fight against nation, nor train for war anymore. Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, love, joy, and peace, remembering the promise of God with prayer. We light this candle of Christ, our hope. May the light sent from God shine in the darkness to show us the way of salvation. Please bow and let's pray. Faithful Father, out of chaos you bring the promise of hope. Renew is in your hope, so we may work towards the love and joy and peace found only in Jesus Christ. Bless us, and may we remember where to focus in this Advent season. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I don't know if you caught what it said in Isaiah. It's actually about a future hope, a future peace, that the weapons that we have will be melted down. They'll no longer be necessary. That when Christ comes back, there will be absolute peace. International disputes will be settled. Now, wouldn't that be a great thing? That's the hope we look forward to. We're getting ready to go into the Benedictus. Amen. So a lot of you have probably heard the song in English. And if you have been to a Catholic church in the past, you may have heard the song in Latin as well. Zachariah's song, and actually, as you look at the video, I just noticed Zachariah's actually misspelled. It's a Z-E, not a Z-A, Zachariah. So Zachariah's song is the Benedictus. But as we get started this morning, at least on the primary message, because I know like today has been like message overload. You get one at the beginning, and then you got one in the Advent, and then you got one in the tithes. I know you're on message overload, but this is actually the primary message. So I want you to think about these words. I read them years ago, and they impacted me. I hope they impact you as well. It's been said that if our greatest need was information, God would send us a teacher. If our greatest need was technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need wasn't any of those things, at least not in this life. Our greatest need is a Savior. Our greatest need is forgiveness of the sins that we've committed, so that we can live in all eternity with hope, peace, love, and joy, what we celebrate at this time. So God knew that. He knew we needed forgiveness, so he sent us a Savior. Our Bibles, as I told you earlier, tells us that God has put eternity in our hearts, and I think we all know that is true. that there is this desire within us to believe that there is something beyond this world. And I tell my son and my daughter and my kids, I said, you know, at the end of your life, there's a test. And it's been an open book test your entire life. Now, if you stand before God and you have read the book and you have studied the book and you come to the conclusion it's not true, maybe you have an excuse. I'm not sure. But if you stand before Him and say, I never took the time to read it, I never took the time to study it, then I'm not sure that you can stand there without excuse. What I do know from almost everybody who has gone to study the Word of God with the simple purpose of denying it, that almost without fail, those that went to discredit found out that it was true. And one of the reasons I think that most people don't read it is simply because they know if they find out it's true, there may have to be some changes in their life. Because if what God says is true, and if we find out that it is true, His Word says if we don't obey those things, then we can't have what He offers. Now, that doesn't mean that we have to clean ourselves up and come to Jesus, because Jesus never says that. So often in churches, it's another reason we started here. People tell you, get yourself cleaned up, come to this altar, and start following God. And God never says it. It says, while we were still in our sin, while we were still sinning, while we were in the midst of the miry clay, in the midst of the muck, God comes along and says, I have come to save you out of your own mess. You're a hot mess, and I'm here to get you right. And I think that is so amazing. You know, it was almost 3 years after Peter began following Christ that he confessed Him as Lord and Savior. That what we call the Great Confession was near the end of Jesus' ministry, not at the beginning. And Jesus says, only God could have revealed that to you. But Peter followed Him for 3 years just to see. Peter saw the miracles. People saw Him. And there was one day that the Holy Spirit just touched Him. He said, without a doubt, you are the living God. So whether you believe or not, we just simply ask you to come along on this odyssey with us. Come along with this journey. Because one day, like Peter, He may open your heart up to the truths of the Scripture. Now, I know that if I had earned my way into heaven, there'd be no hope. So I thank God that He sent us this Savior so that when I stand before Him, He said, why should I let you into my heaven? I can simply say, because of the blood of Christ. That is the only answer you can give. You can't say, because I worked hard, or I went to church, or I gave money, or I did good deeds. It's only through the blood of Christ that any of us can enter into heaven. So anyway, we're in this series, and it's really not a Christmas series, but it sort of is a Christmas series. It starts out in the first two chapters of Luke, and what we find out, if you weren't here last week, and know a lot of you weren't, is that some people believe that Luke is the first hymnologist of the Christian era. Hymnologist is a person who studies and writes hymns, and there's five hymns, at least, just in the first two chapters of Luke. There's other hymns that go throughout other chapters, but just in the first two chapters, there are five. Last week, we studied one called the Magnificat, or the Song of Mary. And one of the reasons the Psalms are named as they are, the Benedictus, which we look at this week, is blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed, Benedictus, Mary, magnify the Lord, Magnificat. Next week we're going to be looking at Simeon's Song, the Nunc Dimittis. So we have all these songs that we have, and then there's two others that's sung by angels, and one of them is very familiar to you, and I'm not going to share that with you quite yet. So anyway, we have these five songs. Two are sung by angels, one sung by Mary, which we looked at last week, one that's sung by Zechariah, who is the father of John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ. That's the one we're looking at this week. And then we have the Nunc Dimittis, which is sung by Simeon. Simeon was a man who was waiting on the Comforter of Israel. In other words, he was waiting on the Anointed One. He was waiting on the Messiah. He was waiting on the Christ child. And as I said, last week we looked at Mary's song. Mary's song for those of you who weren't here, she starts out her song like this. She says, "My soul magnifies the Lord. God, my Savior, my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior." You know, and we looked at her and said, you know, how Mary sings as we should sing. You know, we should sing the same way. And it's not like a magnification where you take something very small and you make it very big. It's like a telescope where you take something that's already great big and you make it even bigger. We magnify the Lord. We expand upon the Lord. We love the Lord. See, here's what we sometimes fail to realize. It's the same way that Jesus was conceived in Mary. It's the same way that Jesus is conceived in us. Maybe not as a baby in the womb, but it says Mary was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is conceived in us, in our hearts, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And as Mary went along carrying this baby Jesus who was conceived in her, it began to form in her, it began to grow in her. And this Christ that's been conceived in our heart by the power of the Holy Spirit, we should nurture it, we should take care of it, and it should begin to grow, and it should begin to form in us as well. But eventually, Mary had to birth Jesus into the world. And we have the very same privilege. We have the very same honor. As Jesus Christ, as you nurture this Jesus Christ who's been conceived in you, as you nurture this Jesus Christ who's being formed in you, who's being grown in you, you should birth him to the world. In fact, we're commanded to do just that. We call it the Great Commission. It's found at the end of Matthew's Gospel. We have the same privilege. We have the same honor that was given to Mary. It has been given to us, to those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as both our Lord and our Savior. And see, I make mention of that often because everybody wants Jesus as their Savior. But the Scripture says we have to pick up our cross and follow Him. We have to make Him not only our Savior, that's the easy part, but to make Him Lord over our lives. We have to begin to act and do the things that He did. The good news is we don't have to do it on our own. This Christ that was conceived in us by the power of the Holy Spirit, that power of the Holy Spirit remains with us to help us do the things that we can't do on our own. We should sing like Mary's song. We should sing loud and we should sing often. We should sing the Magnificent. For He is mighty who has done great things for me, and holy is His name. We should sing out loud, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Now, this morning we're going to be looking at Zachariah's song, or the Benedictus as we call it. And I'm not even going to try to pronounce it in Latin. We did that last week, and I practice a lot and still mess it up pretty good. So my Latin's too rough to even try the Benedictus this morning, as you're going to see shortly. But what we're looking at is the song in particular. Now, the song is found in chapter 1 of the Gospel of Luke. And Luke is actually the third chapter of our New Testament. And we're looking specifically at verses 68 through 79. But the story of Zechariah and his wife, whose name was Elizabeth, actually starts way before that. It starts in chapter 5, and we get a little bit of this, or chapter 1, verse 5, right at the beginning of Luke. And then we get this story of Mary, and then we go into Zechariah's song. So I'm not going to read all the verses to sort of save time this morning. But if you have your Bibles and you would like to look at the Scriptures and read along with me, go ahead and turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 68, and we'll start there. And if you don't have a Bible, that's okay. The words are going to be up here on the screen. And if you would like a Bible, please take one. We've got plenty of them. We've got more in the back. They're right up here. They're free. There's no charge. We want you to have them. That is one thing that we want to give away and never charge for. We want you to have the Word of God in your hand because we know the Word of God will transform your life. Whether you believe in God or not, you do what's in that book and your life will be better. I promise you that.
Amen.
The more you find out, that what's in that book changes your life, the more you find out that Jesus Christ and the holy power and God the Father are the one that actually wrote it, and they're the ones that's changing your life. So we do have, again, a plan for our purpose, and that is to help people see this love of God that we felt in here. And you should be a good steward of the Word of God. You should take a Bible and write notes in it and keep things in it. There's nothing wrong with that. I think God encourages it because you can't trust your memory.
Amen to that.
Okay? So if you write it down, it's going to help you remember it longer. And if you hear something, and it was evident to me this week, I did a Bible study lesson back in 2007, I think it was, or 2008. And I was able to go back to the notes from that Bible study lesson to help me with this week's lesson. So you can always go back and study. So that, again, the story of Zechariah actually begins in chapter 1, verse 4. But in order to save time, I'm not going to read all the verses. I'm just sort of going to give you the Reader's Digest condensed version of it. And I would challenge you to go back and read them on your own. Now, Zechariah was a priest in the temple of God in Jerusalem. He had a high-ranking office. He was the priest. And one day, as was the custom, he got chosen to do something very special. But the story sort of starts out by telling us Zechariah and his wife, Elizabeth, were advanced in years, and they were past childbearing. It tells us that Zechariah was upright and righteous in the sight of God. Now, as I'm reading, I'm thinking, wouldn't it be great someday? Wouldn't it be great someday? Think about this in your own life. If some historian in the future was to look back at your life, would look at the things that you did, look at how you lived, and they would be able to write the same thing. That Rob was righteous and upright in the sight of God. Now, the good part about it is, if you've accepted Jesus Christ in your heart, Holy Spirit lives in you, Christ lives in you, so God looks at you through His Jesus goggles. When that's the only way I can stand in front of God and be called righteous, especially for those of you that know me and upright, is that God looks at me and looks at the Christ in my heart and not at the things that I have done. So we pray that if you're not quite at that point, it's okay. We're glad you're here. We've asked you to come back. We love you. But maybe one day, maybe just one day, you'll see as we see. But Luke tells us that Zechariah and Elizabeth, they've never been able to conceive a child. They were upright, and they were righteous in God's sight. Zechariah may have been upright in man's sight, but Elizabeth was not. Because at that time, if a woman was unable to conceive, it was seen as chastisement or discipline from God. So Mary, not being able to be conceived, everybody figured she must be committing some kind of secret sin that nobody knew about. So as Zechariah is at the temple one day, he's chosen by lot, which is a custom. Now, it could have been drawn straws, which is not very likely, but it could have been. More than likely, they had some things that looked like, maybe the best thing to describe them as dice. They were called Urim and Thummim, and they believed that this was the way that God made decisions, and that His providence and His sovereignty would take over, and they would roll the dice, and whoever won the dice got to go into the temple and light the incense. And this was a great honor. So the first lesson that I see here is God is sovereign over all things, and there are no chances. It looked like it's a game of chance. They're rolling dice. But Zechariah is chosen to go into the temple. And as Zechariah goes into the temple to light the incense, there appears an angel. Does anybody remember what's the first thing an angel says?
Fear not.
Fear not. Do not be afraid. Fear not. So, as angels always do, Zechariah probably goes in like the incense. The angel appears, and it says he was startled and he was afraid. If I walked in here one day to light this candle and I was here by myself and some kind of angel magically appeared, I would be startled and afraid. But he goes, do not be afraid. Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Now, Zechariah was a man of God. He prayed a lot of prayers. So Zechariah is probably going, what prayer is that? He goes, the prayer that you pray that said that you wanted a son. Zechariah, your prayer is very, your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you're to give him the name John. He will be a joy and a light to all of you, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Now Luke starts out by telling us that Elizabeth and Zechariah were advanced in age and past childbearing years. You know, that's just a polite way of saying they were old. And she had passed menopause, and they weren't having no children. So Zechariah is probably thinking to himself, especially, you know, I heard my prayer to have a child. I haven't prayed that prayer in decades, you know. I haven't prayed that prayer for a long, long time. I mean, I can't imagine if they were that advanced in age that he was still praying for a child. And I think there's another lesson in there. God's delays are not necessarily God's denials.
Amen.
Okay? But if he was afraid and startled when the angel appeared to him, now, I'm speaking for myself. If he's as old as the Bible says he is, and as I think he is, I think when the angel said his wife was going to have a child, he was probably about ready to drop down into the grave. Was he... He may have prayed that prayer years ago, but at his age, is he going to have the first child? Now, I speak as a fool, and I'm just kidding, because actually the scriptures tell us they were delighted at this news when they found out it was going to come to pass. In fact, about 5 months into her pregnancy, Elizabeth says, "How kind is the Lord," she exclaimed. "He has taken away my disgrace of having no children." They were delighted they're going to have this child, but, you know, she wasn't pregnant right away. His wife Elizabeth had gone through menopause. He probably had forgotten that he had prayed this prayer in his youth. Luke 1 verses 18 through 20 says, Zechariah said to the angel, "How can I be sure this is going to happen?" Now remember, those are exactly the same words that Mary said. When Mary was told by the angel Gabriel that she was going to have a child, she says, "How can that be?" And now Zechariah says, "How can that be? I'm an old man and my wife is also well along in years." Then the angel says, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence of the Lord. It is he who sent me to bring you the good news. Now, since you didn't believe what I said, you will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born. For my word certainly will be fulfilled at the proper time." Now it's interesting. Mary says the same thing. She magnifies the Lord, and God praises her for obedience. Zechariah says the exact same words. If you go back to the original Greek and Hebrew, they are identical. We translate them a little differently sometimes. And yet, Zechariah is chastised, he's disciplined for his unbelief, and Mary gets praised for her belief. They said the same words. And I think there's another lesson for us to learn there. God looks into our hearts.
Amen.
He sees the real motives behind what we do. We may be able to fool others by our actions and what we say, but you can't fool God. Mary looks at God and looks at the angel and says, "How can this be? I know no man. I know you're going to do it, God. I just don't know how you're going to do it." And Zechariah, he looks at God. He says, "How can this be? Me and my wife are past childbearing. Lord, this is just too big for even you." And again, there's another lesson. All things are possible with God. All things are possible. Even a man and a woman who passed childbearing years. It's possible to have a child with God. All things are possible with God. But Zechariah didn't believe God. So he's chastised. He's disciplined. He's made mute. He's made so he can't talk. So we're going to move forward in time. We're going to move forward in time And it had been at least over 9 months. We don't know the period of time when the proper time was, but it had been at least 9 months, because we get to verse 57 in chapter 1 and we learn that Elizabeth had given birth to a son, just as God has promised. And as was the custom, as the law of Moses commanded, 8 days later they would circumcise the son and they would name him. So the family all comes together for this sacred event of circumcision and naming the child, and everybody's going, you know, you got to name this child Zachariah. That is his dad's name, and his dad can't speak. And they go to Mary and say, got to name the child Zachariah. She goes, nope, not naming Zachariah. We're going to name him John. Now, I know some of you have been in church for a long time, and you probably never heard this before, but they began to argue and say, we ain't never done it that way before. We do it that way, somebody's going to get upset. So let's just keep on doing the same old thing and naming Zachariah. So, of course, they don't believe Mary, so they got to go to John. John can't speak, so he writes down a piece of paper. He will be named John in the scriptures. The scriptures say instantly Zachariah could speak again. And he began praising God. And then in verse 67, and don't miss this is God's words. Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he gave this prophecy. Zechariah is filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't miss this, because we know for at least 9 months, probably a longer period of time, Zechariah has been under the discipline of God. He's been under the hand of God with his chastening. And Zechariah is filled with the Holy Spirit, and he begins to sing. He's not been able to even talk for 9 months. He's been guilty of falling into sin. I mean, we have to call it what it is. He didn't trust God, and according to God's word, when we don't trust God, we are sinning against God. Now, Zechariah, he turns his sin, and he takes his sin, and he turns it into faith. He's renewed, he's restored, he's rejoicing, he's singing. Folks, I'm going to tell you, this is such an important lesson for each one of us. I mean, think about this. Anybody here ever messed up?
No.
I'm pretty much constant in it, okay? So what is our hope? What is our hope when we mess up? How will I ever sing again when I've been guilty of unbelief, when I've been guilty of some sin against? How can I sing again? What is my hope? That my unbelief can be turned into faith, that my sin can be turned into praise, and that I'm going to burst out into song. What is my hope as a pastor? What is my hope for the ministry here at the Odyssey Church? What is my hope for the Great Commission? What is my hope that I can birth Jesus into the world? What is my hope for fellowship? What is my hope for restoration? What is my hope for rejoicing and singing once again? And the answer to all those questions, for you and for me, is we have the same hope that Zechariah had. It's the hope that's found in Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. Only through the Holy Spirit in Christ can we be renewed, can we be restored, can we be able to rejoice again and sing again. So I'm going to read the songs, because you would leave if I sang them, to Zechariah's song, or the Benedictus. So if you'd like, follow along with the words in your Bible, or you can read them silently on the screen for yourself as I read them. And it starts out, praise the Lord, the God of Israel. Because he has visited and redeemed his people. He sent us a mighty Savior from the royal line of his servant David, just as he promised through his holy prophets long ago. Now we will be saved from our enemies and from all who hate us. He has been merciful to our ancestors by remembering his sacred covenant, the covenant which he swore with an oath to our ancestor Abraham. We have been rescued from our enemies so we can serve God without fear, in holiness and righteousness for as long as we live. And he switches gears. And you, my little son, will be called the prophet of the Most High, because you will prepare the way for the Lord. You will tell his people how to find salvation through the forgiveness of their sins. Because of God's tender mercy, the morning light from heaven is about to break upon us. To give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death. And to guide us to the path of peace. John grew up, and that's the son, John the Baptist, grew up and became strong in spirit. And he lived in the wilderness until he began his public ministry to Israel. I find it amazing. His wife has just given birth to a son. Zechariah has not been able to speak for months, maybe years. And what's he do? He doesn't go up and hug his wife. He doesn't go and greet his wife. He doesn't go over to his baby. He begins to sing praises to the Lord. And he sings for the same exact reasons each one of us should sing. Zechariah's song, the message that he gives, is a song of salvation. I mean, if you look at it closely, you're going to see that Zechariah's song, the Benedictus, is actually broken down into two parts. The first part is actually Zechariah singing the Old Testament. And the second part is Zechariah singing about his son. See, Zechariah was a priest. Zechariah knew the scriptures. By the time he was 13 years old, he would have been required to be able to quote the first five chapters of the Bible from memory.
Amen.
He knew the scriptures. He knew the promises of God. He had been able to study them now for at least 9 months uninterrupted. I mean, who's going to go ask a man who can't speak a whole lot of questions, right? We have the advantage of the cross. It's been said that Zechariah saw those things with a flashlight, but we have the advantage of seeing the same things with a spotlight. We have the spotlight of the New Testament, which means we should be able to sing louder, we should be able to sing with more joy, we should be able to sing longer than Zechariah did. See, Zechariah, he knows the scriptures inside and out. He begins to see the promises of God as the promises of God, the old are being fulfilled in the new. God had been silent for 400 years, and now all of a sudden, God is speaking to him and his wife. They're fulfilling the promises that he knew about. The salvation that Moses talked about. The salvation that Abraham was promised. The salvation that David sang about. The salvation that God had been speaking through his prophets for years and years and years. The salvations that the prophets could see from a distance, the promises of God, the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Christ, would come. And now Zechariah sees it all. And he's praising God. In God's wisdom and God's grace and in God's goodness, God has determined to visit mankind with redemption. In his mercy and his grace and his goodness, God has come bringing salvation, forgiving us for our sin, and rescuing us from our enemies. We're going to look at these same verses, but we're going to look at them in the King James Version because they translate it exactly the same way but differently. The words mean the same, it's just translated a different way. We are blessed because God himself has come to redeem us. Blessed, benedictus, is the Lord God of Israel. For he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, just as he promised to do thousands of years ago, just as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets who have been since the world began. See, no matter how dark this world is, no matter how dark this world seems to you right now, there is hope because God always keeps his promises.
Amen.
That we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our Father. And to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham. God has come to deliver his people. God has come to deliver me. God has come to deliver you and to set us free. And he's done so with a purpose. He has done so that we can serve him. To grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, might serve him in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. Zechariah knew the scriptures. He knew this had been God's plan all along. It wasn't plan A to redeem the world through Israel, his chosen people, and since that wasn't working out so well, we'll go to plan B, which is Jesus Christ. Zechariah reads the scripture. Zechariah says, there was never a plan B. It was always plan B. It was Jesus from the very beginning. Jesus has been and always will be plan A. It's always been God's plan to redeem the world through Jesus Christ. There was no plan B. God always planned to send a Redeemer. He announced it to Abraham, and then he announced it to Moses. Then he announced it to David, and then again and again and again through his prophets. Zechariah knew that God had come to visit his people. Zechariah knew that God had come, and he'd come with a purpose. He'd come to redeem his people. Zechariah sings. And because his focus is on Christ, as our focus should be. He knew the Old Testament. He knew in Genesis that Jesus Christ is the seed of the woman. In Exodus, he is the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he is our high priest. In Numbers, he is the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he is the prophet unto Moses. In Joshua, he is the captain of salvation. In Judges, he is our judge and our lawgiver. In Ruth, he is our kingdom redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is our trusted prophet. In Kings and Chronicles, he is our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he is the rebuilder of the broken down walls of our human lives. In Esther, he is our Mordecai. In Job, he is the day spring from on high and our ever-living redeemer. In Psalms, he is the Lord, our shepherd. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he is our wisdom. In the Song of Solomon, Jesus is our lover and the bridegroom. In Isaiah, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. In Jeremiah, Jesus is the righteous branch. In Lamentations, he is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he is the one who assures that dry, dead bones will come alive again.
Amen.
In Daniel, he is the fourth man in the burning fiery forest. In Hosea, he is the faithful husband, forever married to the backslider. To Joel, he is the baptizer with the Holy Spirit and fire. In Amos, he is our burden bearer. In Obadiah, Jesus is the mighty to save. In Jonah, he is our great foreign missionary. In Micah, he is the messenger of beautiful feet carrying the gospel. In Nahum, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In Zephaniah, he is the Savior. In Haggai, he is the restorer of God's lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is the fountain opened in the house of David for sin and uncleanliness. In Malachi, he is the Son of Righteousness, rising with healing in his wings.
Woo-hoo! Good job.
Man, hallelujah.
Zechariah sees the tapestry of God of salvation through every chapter of the what we now call the Old Testament.
You bet.
Zechariah is singing a song of Jesus Christ and the cross. God's people are blessed because God himself has come to dwell among us. And he's come with a plan. He's come with a purpose to redeem us. God's people can have hope because God always keeps his promises. And God's people will be set free. And will be set free to serve him.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Then Zechariah switches gears. He has sung the Old Testament. And now he begins to sing the beginning of the New Testament. He begins to sing of his son John the Baptizer. John is to be the prophet calling in the wilderness, announcing Jesus Christ, announcing the Messiah, announcing God's anointed one to the world. Folks, if you've never read the story of John the Baptist, please take the time to do it, because John the Baptist is a picture of every effective ministry in the world. John is a picture of how all effective ministry operates. It's a picture of how we have been saved for a purpose, how we are to serve God. Zechariah sings, and you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest. For you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give the knowledge of salvation to his people by remission of their sins or by forgiveness of their sins. Through the tender mercy of God, with the day spring from on high, he has visited us to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way and the path. This is what we're to do. We are to do as John the Baptist has done. We are to go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way. We're to give the knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, or in other words, by the forgiveness of our sins through the tender mercies of God. He doesn't beat them out of you. He loves them out of you. We're to be the light and give the light to those who sit in darkness and sit in the shadow of death. To tell others of this Jesus who will guide their feet, who will guide our feet into the ways of peace. Zechariah is teaching us God Himself is the source of our salvation. Zechariah seems to teach us grace is the only reason we can have salvation. We can never earn it. He teaches us salvation includes the insurance of our sins being forgiven. But here's the great thing if you read this. He teaches us salvation just isn't for eternity. We're to sing of our salvation right now, right here, right in this world. We're to always be pointing to Jesus. We're forerunners, just like John the Baptizer was a forerunner. We're to go before Jesus. We're to bring the good news of the gospel, the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ to all the nations of the world. It's not, let's wait till we get to heaven and have salvation. We have it here, now, today.
Yes.
Thank you,
Jesus, yes.
Can you this morning sing like Zechariah? Can you? Will you? Sing the song of God's blessing and God's power and God's promises and God's holiness. Do the people you come in contact with every day, do they hear the song of your experiences with God? Is Jesus Christ real in your life? Is He real in your family life? Is He real when you go to the workplace? Zechariah's song, the Benedictus, it's a picture of God's blessing, of hope, a picture of how God keeps His promises, a picture of our salvation, of our rescue, a picture of our redemption for our sins. We were in darkness, but the sun has risen. We were in darkness, but the sun has risen and it's shone on us and it's glorious and it guides our feet into peace. The sun has risen on the darkness of this world. This is man's great opportunity at redemption and rescue. But let me assure you this morning, it is not just man's opportunity. It is each one of our opportunity. It is your opportunity. For all of you, if you're in darkness, the light of Christ has come knocking right at your door this morning. Through Jesus Christ, you have the opportunity to be redeemed and rescued, to have your sins forgiven, to have a relationship with the living God, the holy God, the eternal God, and to have it once again restored. Repent of your sins and put your faith in Jesus Christ and be redeemed and rescued by making Him Lord over your life, not just your Savior. Try to live as He lived, empowered by the Holy Spirit. See, Zechariah knew the mercy of God. God had revealed His plan and Zechariah is singing the blessings of God. And this morning, if you're burdened, if you're living in darkness this morning, just believe in the forgiveness of God. Believe in the promises of God. Believe in the power of God. Forgiveness doesn't come through anything we do. It's not through any work that we've done in the past, that we can do in the present, or we can do in the future. It's only by the mercy of God, only through His grace, only through the redemptive power of Jesus Christ. God has visited His people and He has redeemed them. All you have to do is accept the offer. That's all. Just accept the offer. Every arrangement has already been made for you. And if you've accepted that offer, understand that God has saved you for a reason. He has saved you for a purpose. He saved you to serve Him without fear. We are, those of us who call ourselves Christians, we are the forerunners of Christ. We're to go before Jesus to prepare the way, to bring the knowledge of salvation to His people by the forgiveness of their sins. We're to tell others of the day spring from on high who has visited us, to give light to those who live in darkness and to guide their feet into peace. What an honor. What a privilege that we, in our human form, in all our hot messes, that we get to be the hands and feet of Christ in this world. One day I asked, I said, Lord, why me? I'm messed up. I'm trying, but I keep failing. And he said, he looks down and says, because you're all I've got. We're it. He has passed the torch from Jesus Christ to us. What an honor. What a privilege. Have you begun to realize this morning that you have more to sing about than Zachariah ever did? I mean, you and I, we have the advantage of the cross, and we know we celebrate it this time of year. Not only did Jesus come in the first Advent, but we're looking forward to the second Advent, the time when He will arrive and He will make the walls perfect again and will live in this world as He designed it to be. No matter how dark your world is, no matter how dark your life may seem in this very moment, Jesus Christ is coming back again, and He is the light of the world. We have the hope of Zechariah. We have the hope of the Benedictus. We have the promises of God, and we should sing as Zechariah sang, blessed is the Lord of Israel, for He has visited and redeemed His people. Let me pray for you, pray for the food we're about to partake in, and pray for our Father. Heavenly Father, I just thank You so much. Father, thank You for Your Word. Father, it's so hard sometimes when there's so much and just so few verses, they just explode as to just pick what we can talk about in 40 minutes, Lord. Father, I love You and I thank You for the opportunity to be Your hands and feet. And we pray, Lord, that we can see these broken down walls around us and that we can be the forerunner of Christ, that we can go tell others of the salvation, of the forgiveness of sins, and that they will lead You, or You will lead us into the path that will lead us to complete peace. Father, we thank You this morning for the privilege and honor to go before You, to have the knowledge of salvation, to tell those who are sitting in darkness of the wonderful light. Father, as we gather together today, just let that light shine upon our fellowship. Let us do what is pleasing to You. And Father, I thank You for all those who have cooked and have brought in food that we're going to enjoy. May it bless us and nourish our bodies to give us the strength to go out and to serve You without fear.